Welcome and thank you for coming to the Carpinteria Arts Center. Thank you so much for braving that traffic. If you came from Santa Barbara, I know that that was probably not a very pleasant experience. But we're here today to celebrate Driven to Abstraction, our incredible abstract exhibit, juried by Rick Stitch.
The great exhibit.
Before Rick comes up and takes the mic for me, which will be very shortly, I want to mention, and I do think that we need to give tribute to the many volunteers who come to the Art Center and help put these exhibits together. To the wonderful Nimmer family who dedicated and gave us completely this wonderful sound system. We had no sound system before. And it's not, you know, cut rate. To Larry Nimmer, who gives of his time, his talent, and his creativity to make sure our shows get out there to people who haven't been here or can't be here, and to all those who are starting to look at us. A true thank you to all the artists who come, because really without you, and without them who aren't here, I mean this magic wouldn't be possible, really. To Romy and Mary, who help hang the show. And of course to Rick himself, who does this from his heart and from his head, because he is truly a very thoughtful juror. We watched him put the show together. We said not a word to him. He said not a word to us. But you could just hear and see the mind working, the steam coming out of the brain. I think you will agree with me that Rick has kind of developed an intimacy that has probably come from a lifetime of surfing, a true California native son, and that intimacy is brought to life in his art. There's an interplay of light, water, and reflection and color that he has caught, and caught so beautifully. We thank you very much. So that's enough from me. Let's hear from Rick.
Is that good? Hi. Yeah, I can. I can see you too. Well, first of all, thank you so much for inviting me to be your juror in this, for this exhibition. It's been a real pleasure. And I'd like to thank, you know, everybody who worked on the show, and it's a special invitation for me. A lot of you, actually I didn't look at any tags, but I recognize a lot of people who I've had the pleasure to have been with in my classes and in other contexts as well. So thanks for coming. I feel pretty attached to CARP. When our family came here, I was invited to teach at Creative Studies as artist in residence. And I had a studio in Santa Monica and was part of LA, and I thought, well, this would be nice for a little break. And so they rehired me at Creative Studies and kept rehiring me. And I go, honey, you want to go back to LA? Don't want to go back to LA. So that was it. And I had a studio on 9th Street, but I could probably throw a rock at it from here. And I love Carpinteria. So congratulations, you know, you got an art center, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm getting old now, 65. I was actually at a meeting where Mocha started in LA, Dwayne Valentine's studio, and this is how it starts, right? There is no building, there's nothing. There's just a bunch of artists and a bunch of people who care about art, you know. And they all, who wants to do it? Everybody raises up their hand. Okay, we're going to do it, you know. And it's kind of fun to watch that, you know. Next thing you know, you got a museum. So you got a good thing going on, you know. Happy to be here. I guess I should say something about the show, right? That would be good. And then we could take a little tour, maybe, if anybody's interested in looking at specific paintings. We could talk about those a little bit. I've had something on my mind which is going to be hard to address, really, but I think I'll just start with it in a hopefully in a positive way. That's that, you know, being a juror it's an honor, and it's kind of a curse at the same time, as you might imagine, because some people are going to win and some people are not going to win, and some people are going to get in and some people are not going to get in, right? Especially, you know, your space is nice, but it's not real big. So, just one thing about winning and losing and getting in and not getting in, and you know, let me relate a little thing that I think, Mary, you've heard me tell this story before. You know, when I was just out of school, know nothing, still the same way, and still don't know anything. I saw a show at Gemini, and I in L.A. That's where they print fine art. And I walked in, and I said, "This is where you make the prints and everything." I said, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, who's printing now?" And they said, "Jasper Johns." And I said, "Really?" "Yeah." And I said, "Gee, I'd really like to meet Jasper Johns someday. That'd be great." And Sid Felsen said, "Well, why don't you leave him a note?" And I did. And I was walking out the door, and Sid says, he likes to see if people do this. He likes to see what you do. So why don't you bring a couple drawings with you, something like that. So come back on Friday when we're done, and we'll look at the prints. And you can talk to Jasper. So I came back, and in the proofing room, instead of the prints, he put up my drawings. So I sat in a chair. This is like, seems like a dream. And spent a pretty good part of the morning. You know, it's fun. Had coffee, looked at the pictures, and then he showed me his prints, right? And why am I telling you all this? It's kind of fun to be a name dropper all the time anyway, but that's not why I'm telling you this. So, I looked up at the prints, and I looked up at the work, and I looked back at Jasper, and I said, "Well, what do you think, Jasper? You think I could do this? You think I could be an artist?" And he said, "You know, Rick, you're the only one that can answer that question." So, anybody, you know, it's all a matter of opinion on one level. Everybody's got to make up their mind whether they think the work is any good. And, you know, if it is, you know, charge ahead. If you think you need some more work, you know, work on it a little more. So that's how I'm going to address getting in or not getting in, or winning or losing, or it's all subjective. Okay? The show, once it went up, was I think everyone would agree, is an amazing show. It really is. It's an amazing show. And nice surprise, I think, not only to me, but everybody. I mean, I came to the opening, and I saw people's reaction. Really good, you know. So I think everybody should be really proud of it. There's things about this particular body of work, which is in this context, and in the way people are approaching this, there's a lot of, for me, there's a lot of sincerity. There's a lot of, there's not a lot of artificiality. There's a lot of sincerity. It's things that people feel affinities with, you know, the ocean and landscape or still life or something like that. And it shows in the work. So it's not about, you know, making something flashy or slick or trying to get people's attention. It's more about making something that's close to your experience, right? And I think that comes across really, really well in this show. And I couldn't say that about every show that I've seen lately or juried or, you know. Oftentimes, what I think we all hope is going to be in an exhibition or in pictures that we're looking at is, you know, something that's very genuine, something that's very hopefully not predictable. The experience of the artist is a unique one, and you that's conveyed through the picture. So you're seeing it again through that artist's eyes, and it's a new, hopefully it's a new window you're looking through in that painting. Oftentimes, things can become predictable, even if they're very handsome or lovely. I think we've all had the experience of being drawn into a picture and then being repulsed by it, you know, by virtue of the fact that whatever it was that was seductive quickly becomes familiar, and you got it, and it's not that interesting anymore. So making art in a lot of ways is taking, I think, what's right in front of you. When I have the classes, sometimes I teach abstract art. I don't know if that can be taught, but I help people with their abstract painting. And it's the case with all of us. You know, what is it that I'm going to paint? You know, what do I want to get into here? What do I want to get involved in terms of subject matter or whatever? So I oftentimes say, if you look at great art, let's just for the fun of it, yell out anybody. I don't care. Name me an artist.
Picasso.
Okay. Let's take Picasso's paintings. Okay. You might be thinking of cubism. Right, or you might be thinking of the women paintings, which there's a lot of, right? Well, what I tell my students, and what I think is true for most great art, whatever it is about 10 feet or less away from them. You know, for Matisse, it's the window that he looks out, or the studio itself, if you think of paintings like the Red Studio, or if you think of Picasso's paintings, right? The women, you know, well, Maria Teresa is right here, right? Unless she's left already, or any of Picasso's subjects, right? Even you know, if you like the funny paintings with the goats or anything, doesn't matter. It's all about 10 feet away, right? Then you could say, well, what about something like Kandinsky? I mean, that looks like outer space, right? Or that looks really abstract. Then how does that work? Most of the images, most of the things in Kandinsky's work comes from his love of the spiritual and philosophy. So actually the books in Kandinsky's studio from where his mixing table are about right here, if you look at the pictures. And that's what's important to Vasily Kandinsky. Experience, you know, that you bring with you, well, that's a lot less than 10 feet away. Right? Yeah. Or, you know, heart, mind, your emotional state, whatever. And a lot of art is about that. So it's not something, you know, 150,000 miles away. Sometimes in Kandinsky's paintings it looks that way. But I think it's actually quite close. I don't find any exceptions to that, really. I mean, even if you take somebody, I was thinking, well, how does that work with somebody like Lichtenstein, right? Who's just all over the place, right? Well, or Jasper Johns, you know? Well, they live in art. They live in art history, and they know it, right? So it's all right there. It's all in the studio. I don't know where I got off on that. Rambling on. Okay.
Your head is sage.
Yeah. So, are there any questions about the exhibit, or any comments that you want to make, or as long as you just didn't bring, you know, like a bow and arrow or anything like that with you.
will you take us inside and explain why you gave the awards to certain pieces?
Absolutely. Is there anything general while we're all together? Yes.
What would your description be of abstract?
Well, that's a good question.
Repeat the question.
What would your description be of abstract art?
What would my description be of abstract art? Okay. Very briefly, right? When I was a young artist, I was an artist carpenter in Venice. And there was a bunch of abstract painters there. And at that time, they had, I got tired of hearing about it every day too. They had this sort of dogmatic stance. Abstract art is this. It can't have this and it can't have all these parameters and rules, you know. And their work was very like solid color paintings and things like that. I mean, some of them were really good painters, you know. But I got really tired of their dogmatic thing. And so that's what they said abstract art was. You know, other people, if they show you, they can show you something by Picasso and say, well, that's a really abstract painting, right? And this crew from the more minimal side says, those aren't abstract paintings at all. Those are figurative paintings, right? And there's always been this kind of back and forth. You know, how do you figure that out, or how do you describe that, especially if you're a curator, right? So then we had an era where there were lots of shows called Abstraction, right? They use that word, abstraction, which basically means that if you saw that in the title, you know, you kind of knew what kind of a show you were going to. This was going to be a show where people had used some sort of recognizable imagery or not, and they abstracted from it. They took something from that subject or whatever, and instead of being just very realistic, they kind of made it a hybrid between abstraction and the figure, abstraction and landscape. Dievenkorn would be an excellent example here of someone who would be in a show that would be like abstraction, because you'd see landscape, but you'd also see abstract paintings. You know, for my own little effort, I had a painting I was asked to put a painting in the show. I've always enjoyed the edge between both. And sometimes it falls over into, you know, landscape or whatever it is, the figure. Oftentimes, my goal is to have it somewhere so that it's both. Right. An abstraction from nature in some sense, usually for me, it's usually water. So, you know, I guess to try to answer, I don't think I can really answer your question, but to try and approach what you're asking, it's very broad. And I tried to read Kandinsky's The Spiritual in Art, which he lays out what abstract art is. And, you know, my daughter could read it. She took art history at a good school, and she could read it, and I couldn't understand hardly a page of it. I couldn't. And I actually read some of the books he read, stuff like that. I studied them. But what he said about abstraction, pretty. It was pretty obtuse. It was pretty hard to understand. Yeah?
Who are your top five abstract artists?
Top five? Abstract artists. Gee.
Top five.
Just like that. Well, let's see. I just have to tell you that when I go here, here's maybe an easy way to do it. What I gravitate towards. Our daughter moved to New York, so we end up, you know, going on the plane now is like going on the bus to the family thing. You know, it used to be. So we're there. So I try to see the shows. Where do I wander when I go to the modern or say the Met? Right. I always like to sit in front of the Rothkos. Just like everybody else does, right? I'm no different. It's just like Mark Rothko is an incredible painter. He was an incredible painter. I like Kandinsky a lot. I do the same thing. I go to Kandinsky's a lot. I had great privilege of getting to know Sam Francis a little bit when he was alive. I like Sam's. I always like Sam's paintings a lot. Jasper Johns, I mentioned. How many we got now?
Four.
And Bob Rauschenberg, is that does that count?
Yes. Yeah.
Sure.
No, you didn't say it, but no.
Rauschenberg.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, without question. Yeah, Rauschenberg was like unbelievable, really. Unbelievable. Yeah. What's that? Pollock?
Pollock, your favorite.
Okay, can I do six?
Do ten.
Well, six, I'm glad you mentioned that, Mary, especially in the context of your question, and both questions, because I'll tell you why. What I said was I was going to try to bring up that list in relation to actually walking around a museum and what do I gravitate towards. And I do the same with Pollock. I sit in front of Pollock's paintings. One thing that I've conveyed, you've probably heard me say this too if you've been in my classes, is that if you go through a museum like that, or let's just say the Met in New York. So in the Met, it's a storehouse of humanity, art. I mean, this is really the top of the class, whether you're talking about Greek sculpture, you're talking about, they have incredible African and everything, right? Classical paintings. You know, you name it, Renaissance, everything. So it's all right there in this building. But when you get to Pollock, there's nothing in that building that prepares you for Jackson Pollock. Nothing, right? So, yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that, Mary. Yeah.
Where do you think abstract art is going in the future?
In the future? I have no idea, really. Yeah, because you know, it's so surprising to me. What's your name?
Carlos.
You know, I mean, every time I turn around, I for some reason this week I've been to a lot of different exhibitions. Friends were in shows at UCSB and stuff like that, and I have to confess that I'm amazed at what people come up with, what they do, what they explore. And it's astounding. It really is. I never get over it, you know. My wife and I went to a show at the Brooklyn Museum last visit, and Oliphant is an artist from Africa, and he, what he does, I just find these things incredible, is he does tapestries out of the seals on liquor bottles, bottle caps and liquor seals, and they're always, as all liquor bottles are, they're you know, there's a tequila bottle back there, they're always illustrious, they're always gold and shiny and, you know, like that. So he actually has a whole village collecting them out of dumps. And where people consume a lot of alcohol, he has those people saving those things, right? All over this region of Africa. So he's got a whole village employed in kind of a little factory. Well, it's a pretty good-sized factory, making these tapestries. And so when you see them, a typical one of his tapestries would cover that whole awning there, right? They're huge. You know, I'm gonna. I pronounce it Oliphant, but that's probably wrong. Okay, but I'll get it for you. Okay. Does anybody know that name?
I'm not sure what his name is, but one of his works is hanging in San Francisco right now.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yeah. I mean, it's incredible. They're incredible tapestries. You know. So this is the Brooklyn Museum, and we're walking through five galleries that are the size of this yard, filled with these things.
Oh my God.
So, and they're all these big like curtains, and they wave around, and he's covered buildings with them and all kinds of things. And it just amazes me that he's just one of a whole bunch of artists in the world who do stuff like this.
El Anatsui.
There you go. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
No, I didn't know it.
Thank you.
My brain.
So, back to your question about
where is it going?
The direction. You know, it's the wonderful thing about art is that it doesn't have any predictable direction, you know, because, you know, some baby was born yesterday and that he or she is going to just knock everybody out of the water when they're, you know, by the time when they're 24, right? And just like, what, where are we now? You know, and that's the wonderful thing about art. It really is. Yeah.
I've heard some people say there's a difference between abstraction and non-representational art.
Uh-huh.
Is there a distinction? One they say is you take something representational and you abstract it, or if there's nothing about it representational, then it's non-representational.
Yeah.
Is there a distinction?
Yeah. Oftentimes you hear that described as non-objective.
Okay.
So, non-objective means there's no object, there's no recognizable object in that picture.
It's different than abstraction.
Well, when it becomes non-objective, then yes, it does it for all intents and purposes. Let's say I make a, let's say you know Joseph Albers.
Yes.
Let's say let's take one. Everybody, I guess everybody knows Pollock. I always say, also, if you don't know any of the artists that we're talking about, I do this in classes too, you know, I'm actually happy for you. Because if you're here and you're that interested, you got a lot of great stuff ahead of you,
yeah.
Right? Because it really is. It's really exciting. It's really amazing, right? So Kandinsky's paintings, you know, started out with blue writers in them, right? With very recognizable things, and they moved into non-objective paintings, and then he became very adamant about the fact that there weren't objects in there. They were resonances, and they were colors, and they were things like that. You know, I mentioned Joseph Albers, or Rothko would be very much the same. It's the relationship of those colors and their proportions of those colors, things like that. So it's not about a building or a tree or something else. Although some of them look a lot like Turner's. And that was very much about, you know, the yeah. sky and the horizon line and the sea. So, in a lot of ways, there's a lot of non-objective, even these guys I mentioned in Venice, you know, they'd be doing these monochromatic paintings, right? And first they're black, and then they're kind of gray, and then some blue starts to creep in. And I say, well, duh, Jimmy, you live a block from the beach. Okay. No, anyway. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not familiar with abstract painting. Can you tell me some of the styles of abstract painting that have been in the past?
Some of the styles, some of the different things that have been done in the past? Is that fair? Well, again, real briefly, when you have about the turn of the century, to really make this concise, and actually before I mentioned Turner, before that, you have in the West, you have all landscape, figure, images, things like that. No one just does, hey, I think red will look great all by itself. Nobody does that, except with one exception, that's Turner. So he decides, hey, if the sky is red and orange and the sea is blue and this is my notebook, why do I have to do anything else? He might scribble something in there that might look like, may or may not look like a boat, but it's fairly clear when you look at his notebooks that he doesn't really care. He's more interested in the relationship of the blue and the orange to, you know, the red and the orange to the blue. That's what he's really interested in. So you say, okay, well then when the century turns and we get abstract paintings being done for the first time by mainly Kandinsky and then Paul Klee and those artists, right, that were around Kandinsky. Here in America, Arthur Dove, that doesn't happen until around 1910. So before that, you have indications that that's going to happen. Monet's last painting, everybody knows who Monet is, but if I show them some of Monet's late paintings, they won't recognize them. And that's, you know, that's I'm not faulting them for that. I wouldn't have recognized them either, because I think of Monet as having the garden and all that kind of stuff. And now I'm looking at these huge brushstrokes and this almost abstract painting. I'm talking about the wisteria paintings and the late paintings that were done around the time that he did the murals for the Orangerie. So all of a sudden, there you can't tell. It's a bunch of color, right? You can't tell anymore what's in there. From there, you're gonna have abstraction. But there's something that's important to say at this point. That's for the West. The American Indians, every other continent had abstract art. I don't care where you go. I mean, and good abstract art. You know, not to mention things like, you know, stained glass, and you know, those are non-objective paintings. I mean, they may look like rosettes, maybe the great ones that you think of, but they're abstractions, right? So there was lots of precedent for that. I mean, all you have to do is look at a really great, any great culture. That's all you got to do, and see what their art looks like, and you're going to find lots of abstraction there, and some abstract paintings to boot, you know, especially Japan, China, India. So we're actually newcomers to abstract art, but it gets played another way. Yeah, were you going to say something, Anne?
Yeah, I was just wondering about the influence of cave paintings on abstract.
Huge, absolutely huge, yeah. And I can say that with a lot of confidence because I've done slideshows over and over and over and over again for my classes, and I keep discovering more and more stuff in early abstract paintings that came out of cave paintings. Some of them, like in Paul Klee's case, he literally lifted it out of the cave paintings. And does that mean, you know, he's not genuine? No, it's absolutely genuine. He enjoyed the color. He had his own mark making, his own symbols, but it's basically the same format that the cave painters used. And, you know, was that because it was a novelty to those guys? No, they're geniuses. They recognize right away what that is. You know, that's like a gold mine. That's what it was for Picasso and everybody else. Quote unquote primitive art, you know. When Braque got interested in collecting the masks, Picasso also had African masks, but when they both realized what was going on, and they weren't the only ones, everything was about primitive art. And you only have to look backwards a little bit to see Gauguin and what he's up to, what he's doing. He's really trying to live there. I just saw a show last year in New York about his experience with all his drawings, prints, ceramics, carvings, sculpture, paintings, on and on, right? Writings. He wrote a book called Noah Noah. It was all about immersing himself in that kind of a consciousness. You know, that prior time before all the complications. Yeah. So, good question. Good question. Should we go look at the show? Yeah, or... Teddy, do you have a...
Are we ready to go look at this stuff?
I want to make a slight correction. I made a major faux pas. Susan Meisner and her family are responsible for this wonderful sound system, and Larry Nimmer is responsible for our wonderful videography.
And where's Susan? Nice, Susan. Fabulous.
Thank you.
And how do you say his name?
I'm gonna have to.
Okay, it'll be on our.
I'm gonna have to ask Bing. Okay.
Go ahead.
So, shall we just start in this room? And this is, we want to start right with the third prize winner here, which is Romy. And Romy, are you around?
She is.
Okay.
There she is.
It might be fun sometimes if we're going to look at it to look also have the artist here. Be fun. Well, I was struck with a lot of things about this picture, actually. Mainly the color and the overall, aspect of the painting. Oftentimes you have, in landscape, you have things, in literal landscape, you have everything sort of spelled out for you. Here, a lot of it is just really suggested. And she's done that through color. But she's also done it through this, I think, very beautiful, simple kind of classic abstract landscape is to give you a path into the painting, right? And, it's a good painting. I repeat this to my classes a lot. A good painting draws you in. So you were drawn into this picture, which she's painted for us to move into a landscape that's Romy's landscape. It might be based on something that she remembers or is familiar with, but it's changed from all that, and now we're involved in Romy's landscape, which is here. Which we always hope that's going to be a unique experience, and indeed, in this case, it is. And I'm reminded when I look at this painting of some really great British landscape, especially that I like a lot. And it has to do with the same thing. It's more suggestion than it is anything specific. So should we go on to?
Would that be the line?
Yeah. Well, why don't we just go around this wall right here, and I'll just make a few comments. I confess I don't. There's Mary Fredericks, and I don't think she's here. But these two by Mary.
No, I did that one.
Oh, you did that one.
I did that one.
Okay. So let's talk about these two pictures, which actually both of them have a lot of what I was just talking about. This one, it's more of a suggestion. Okay, and I think the virtue of that in abstract painting is that the viewer then gets to play a part in the picture. It's open to interpretation, things like that. So if you want to see, if you enjoy seeing something there or not, you can you can make it up as you go along as the viewer. And I think that's interesting. It's not a static image. In that case, it's in motion. There's a few photographic pieces, especially nice one, these wildflowers. And I always want to see who this is. Reyes McDonald. Anyway, let's keep going here. Julie Banks, is she here? No? Okay. Who's that?
Tony
Noonan. Okay, is Tony here?
No.
No. Okay. Okay. Well.
He's got friends here who tell him. He represents what you have to say.
Did you tell him to make that painting? No, I'm just kidding. That's really, really lovely painting. Let's go for the one on the top right away. And there was a question earlier about how abstract art was developed, things like that. One thing that happened was Cubism, and that was a very big thing that happened. And when that happened, images that the artist had been involved in, whether they were figurative, in Picasso's case or in Braque's case, more landscape-oriented, now instead of just one view or one surface, they were starting to give us more than one view or more than one perspective in the painting. And of course, when people saw that, they had no track record at all in their thinking about the world. It was very, very one-dimensional before that. And so this really opened things up. Subsequent to that, I should say concurrent with that was cinema, where things did have different perspectives and they did you did have motion and change and things like that. So all of that, oddly or not enough, was at the same time Einstein developed relativity. And you find out that, in short, things aren't exactly the way we thought they were, right? And actually, some of the art is closer, and the science is closer to reality than what we thought. So perception and art and science seem to have a lot to do with one another, and they always do. There's been great shows about that. One of them was Art and Technology in LA, and that was, I think they just celebrated some sort of an anniversary of that show, but I remember seeing it when I was really young and being amazed by the idea of a physicist and an artist, you know, getting together and developing something that was, you know, truly wonderful. And what a great thing. Like, you can imagine these artists were at Caltech and other places and just doing marvelous things. Some of them were just absolutely phenomenal. So anyway, I don't know how I got off on all that, except that Cubism was one of the, was not a small factor in all that, that change. And so when there's nothing really new under the sun. I mean, there's precedence for every painting in this show and everyone in my studio, you know, and that's not the point. The point is, can you make it your own, right? Whatever that is. If it's landscape, or if it's has to do with, like I just mentioned, science or cubism or, you know, abstraction of some sort, can you make it your own? And that's the point. Can you bring something to it that's of your own experience and of your own making? So where should we go now? Larry? Okay. Hi, how are you? You're dutiful in your station.
Thank you.
This is where you were. This is where I recognize you.
I live here.
You live right there.
Right here.
Okay. Okay. I'm gonna move the. You know, sometimes you just have to tell the devil to get move over. God, always around. Is that yours?
Yes.
That's really, by the way, it's really, really, we'll talk about that in just a second. Okay. Let me just focus on Beth's painting for a minute here and talk about, I actually do know her work. I did not recognize this painting when I picked it. I'm not sure that I even had a clue, Beth, actually. Because I don't think I've seen your paintings for a little while. But Beth and I were together for a while and had the fun of watching her for years, yeah, developing her work. And we had a brief conversation last time, which I'm going to share with everybody if you don't mind, which is when people that I'm with, and, you know, like I said, I'm getting old now. I've had a lot of experiences and people for years have become artists and things like that. When you're starting out, you know, I'm like dear old dad, right? When you get good, it's another story, right? The closer you get to being, which I definitely consider Beth, you know, a contemporary artist, than as it was with myself. And I, you know, you kind of get this as part of what this is all about, you know, is you don't pull any punches after that point, right?
Right.
And sometimes you throw some.
One or two,
yeah. But Beth was up for it. She was tough enough for that. And did, I thought, a really fine job on the things when I had you a little closer at hand. So seeing this, so this was a real delight to me, Beth, and I'll tell you why. Because there's things about the picture that I feel should be familiar to me, and but they're not. And there's things that you could have left well enough alone. And that's one of the reasons I picked it. Several times in the painting, I can tell that by looking at it, right? By that I mean, gee, this could be okay just like that, right? But okay, just okay, or good enough is not good enough, especially in art. Good enough is, that's not anywhere near art.
Right.
Okay? Better than you expected is getting closer. You know, phenomenal, all, you know, all those things, it's really got to get beyond, you know, what you're expecting, basically. So it was an unexpected surprise, Beth, and, you know, it's terrific. There's a lot of, and I hope you keep it up, you know. Just on a personal note, you know, I'd love to see you do some very large paintings that have to do with, you know, I think the direction that got you here, let's put it that way, right? Okay,
that's great. I'll let you know when I did that.
Let me know. Yeah, and that's like the next step. Then,
right.
Then,
good challenge, yeah.
Then you can invite me to your studio, right?
Yeah.
Which is exactly what I did. I just told you in the talk, right? Okay. So let's look at the devil. Let's see if the devil needs more attention. Let's tell us about your sculpture. I actually want to hear about the. Yeah, how it came about. Yeah.
Well, intriguing. I did a series of sculptures in which I took sticks and added wax, mm-hmm. made them into something recognizably human, and cast them using the lost wax process.
Okay.
Cast using the lost wax. So he started out life as a branch.
Uh-huh.
And this added.
Uh-huh.
Avid. Uh-huh. These are branches also. Uh-huh. And
where did you cast it?
That one I cast at Genesis Bronze. My uh-huh. first stuff I did myself at City College.
You did.
This took on much work.
Yeah.
So, they don't want to burn out sticks anymore, which is a problem because uh-huh. it's very expensive to make a mold or something like this. So you can get one. But if you burn it out long enough, you can just treat it like wax in the lost wax process. And how did I find him? And, you know, I saw something.
In there.
In yeah. there, and I made something, and then it was okay.
Well, you know, I saw it, I liked it, I went by it, and it occurred to me that the devil came out of fire and the whole,
oh,
I don't know if
oh,
it,
I didn't even think
if
of
it crossed.
No, I really...
No, it's really really kind of a funny, you know, it's a funny guy. He's born in fire, you know.
Yeah, but that was subconscious if it happened.
So yeah. No, it's a really terrific piece.
Thank you.
It really is. Way beyond anything I would have expected to find here. You know, it's like, wow.
From... Oh, okay.
I didn't expect to see the devil in that form. You know,
oh, okay.
in such a wonderful
well,
sculpture,
you.
Yeah. Yeah, really good. Let's talk about this one, second place. Oh, we got a good shot of this, Larry? Okay. So where's Meg?
Right here.
Okay.
Just going to get a quick shot.
Okay, absolutely.
Go ahead.
Meg, this was actually, you guys were running neck and neck for a while, and I thought this was a really terrific piece. And I saw it from different. I'd be looking at something over there, and I'd turn around, and it would catch my eye, and I would get drawn back into it again. And that was something. That's one of the criteria I use for what I think is interesting, and what. I get asked the question too, you know, what's art and how do you determine what's a piece of art, stuff like that. You know, that question over and over and over again, so I have to keep returning to that myself, of course, you know. But over the years, one of the criteria, one of the things that's happened to me is a notion that I came across was it compelling in any way to you, this whatever it was. And I remember seeing several pieces in my life that were, Anselm Kiefer was one, and I didn't even want to look at it, you know, but I couldn't help it. I kept getting drawn back into this painting, right? And several others, but so that's the way it was. I kept coming back to your little painting. And just out of curiosity, how did you develop this? What was...
I don't like to waste things, so I would take my oil palette and make a monoprint on Wallace pastel paper mm-hmm. with it, and then use it for background, because Turnwriter was just making background some of the time. I thought, sooner or later I'll use this for something. And then that one, I liked the kind of some of the large things that were in there. And I ground up old pastels. When I have tiny bits of pastel, I grind them up and use them too. So I ground pastels into there. And then I've been looking at kelp and at a cypress branch. And just like I love the branches in that devil. And that was a drawing of a cypress branch. I thought I'm going to put that drawing on that paper and then just flip that thing across the top to give it a suggestion of something.
Well, it's really, 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 really good. Yeah. Thank you. Enjoyed that a lot. Let me ask a question to you all. Is there something that you'd like to focus on? Is there something? Yeah. Okay. Good.
I have a question.
Sure.
I always thought abstract art was something when you look at it, you don't really know what it is.
Uh huh.
But to the artist, they know what it is. Some of the pictures in here, to me, are more realistic than abstract.
Mm-hmm.
And
several.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, why were they chosen for an abstract show?
Okay. Let me address that. I think I mentioned outside a little bit about the broader definition of abstract painting was abstraction. Okay? What's the title of the show?
Driven to Abstraction.
Yeah, abstraction. So along the drive, some folks got out of the car fairly early, while others continued. But it's all the, you know, it's all that road, basically. And that doesn't necessarily mean that the people that kept going didn't crash. Several of them did. Some of the early attempts at abstract painting, or some of the things that led into abstraction, the Fauve. So let's say if you know, like Matisse in the early years, like around 1910, or before, 1905 actually. Like, you know the painting Dance, the incredible painting Dance. It comes from a Fauve period painting called The Joy of Life, where there's all these figures in it. And if you look at that painting, you're going to find Matisse's whole history is in like a nutshell in the painting, right? Along with, if you really look at the painting, along with a lot of abstraction, although it's not particularly an abstract painting, right? So, in a way, it's all in the same, if you look at it that way, it's all in the same field, let's say. It just has different aspects, abstraction. Now, if it was abstract, and that might be a little tougher, right? That might be a little tougher, but abstraction's a little easier.
Thank you.
I mean, it's not, and it's not really semantics. It really has to do with, I think, wanting to be inclusive as well. So I'm glad you guys picked that title, because that would exclude a lot of abstract would exclude a lot of people. Okay, so we do want to look at something. And which one do we want to look at? The top one.
Yeah, why did you like
okay,
that?
Okay, let's find out. What? Okay, so this is Karen Luckett. Venice Beach by day and night. Okay? Karen here.
Right here.
Oh! No wonder.
Did you like the name because you said you were from Venice or something?
I'm tempted to say, I got my, people say, do you have a master's degree? And I don't. You know, I have equivalent of master's degree since teaching at the university gives me a master's degree. But actually, you know, I joke sometimes. I say, yeah, I got my master's degree in Venice. You know? Yeah, drinking with everybody. I'll tell you, I remember, like, I have a good memory for pictures, actually. Not for much else, but pretty good for pictures. There are some things in this painting. There's a surreal aspect to it, which I actually like a lot. There's calligraphy in there. So you say, okay, well, a lot of it, surrealism roughly is, we all know what that is, right? Like Salvador Dali, things like that, right? Things that appear to be images, or they're images, but they're more like from dreams or something like that. So it has that nature to it. It has calligraphy in it. It's got, you seem to be, you know, interested in color. And so you've got a lot of things in the same painting.
It's cryptology.
Pretty ambitious.
And if you know how to read cryptology,
yep,
it actually tells you where the Russian nuclear warheads are buried.
There you go. I knew it was there. All the time.
But I had to. We were studying cryptology by a military guy when I did this.
Very good.
And so you can call it calligraphy.
Good.
And they're buried in Venice Beach or
Well, good show. Okay. Yeah, do you know who Cy Twombly is?
What was that?
Cy Twombly?
No.
Oh, Cy Twombly.
Look it up. Okay. Look it up. It's okay. Like I say, I'm happy for you.
Yeah, okay. Look up some.
You're gonna say something now.
If you wanted to go into that room, we could just kind of hold the piece at the doorway if you wanted.
Okay.
And then that way they're not all suffocating.
All right. Yeah. No, I can hear people thinking, let's bring this in for a landing. All right.
This has an honorable mention on it. Do you want us to hold this at the doorway for you, or you want it already in?
Brief.
Okay, go ahead.
Beverly Decker's painting. You know, this happened the last time. This is the second show that I've juried here. I can't remember. I think both of them were abstract shows, or abstraction. Beverly actually, I didn't recognize her work. She did broken surfboards and things like that prior to this, so I didn't know who this was. And then it was a nice surprise to see her doing this. And I have no idea what the pictures are about. I don't know if the title gives any of that away or what. But absolutely not. H1J2. I don't think any of us will decipher that. But one thing I do know is that the illustrative nature, the overall picture part of it, reminds me a lot of Gustav Klimt.
Yeah.
And so I would say that I'd bet on it that she's enamored at this point with Gustav Klimt. And I could say that about, I could take any one of these pictures. And I mean, the easiest one, why don't we switch rooms? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, okay.
This one's mine. I wondered if you did you make a brief comment?
Absolutely. And
yeah,
without even asking you about what the picture's about or anything like that, and again, take it with a grain of salt. This is from my little experience. That's all it is. You know, we've got some kind of an aperture here, like a cave or something like that, that we're coming out of. It reminds me of, there's a cave on Santa Cruz Island that you can sail out of. You know, you can actually sail into it and sail out. At first I thought, when I heard it described, I thought, well, they mean motor into the cave. They don't mean sail into the cave. But I actually have seen boats sail into the cave, you know, slowly. That's that big. The mast and all goes into the cave. And it's quite extraordinary. And so that's what this picture reminds me of, and I have absolutely no idea after that what it's about. And I'd like to, you know, it's intriguing. What is it about?
Well, it's about that.
It's about that cave.
Right. Okay. Oh, yeah.
And it's...
Do you have a boat?
No.
No.
But I've been out there.
You've been on a boat. Yeah. It's extraordinary, isn't it? Yeah. And I think it would be hard for any painter to have that experience and not, you know, respond to that as an incredible picture when you're turning back out to go out into the light. And also the sea right there, there's a rock formation on one side of this that shelters the sea from this opening. It's an extraordinary place, really. So that means that the water right in there is calm. and it's relatively calm. And sometimes it's the color of your jacket or your shirt, you know.
Yeah, the name is Sanctuary.
So really it's like, yeah, it's like a church.
Like a sanctuary.
Yeah. It's like, it is.
And that's the name of the band.
Yeah.
No. Yesterday, it was nice. Pure green.
You were there?
I was you were there. See? Wow. Right? I've seen it bottled green. Yeah. Like, the most extraordinary bottled green. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Where is it?
It's just
where
one that has the
Sanic and everything. I just
made this. Resin from the ashes.
Sorry.
Huh? Yeah? No? And it's mixed media. It looks like it's on paper. I wonder, do you know Delaney? Maybe she's not here.
I just think it's kind of...
What do you think?
Well, I like the texture and everything, but I think after a while I would... I mean, I'm not... It's not taking me way in, down a path.
We were talking about that earlier,
right.
Weren't we? Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Okay. I like this one better.
Uh-huh.
Is this you?
No, I'm not. I didn't enter anything.
That's a beautiful. That's gorgeous.
If I did, I'm Michael sure Hector. It would be in. But
it's so it's so gorgeous.
Yeah. Wow.
Can I ask you about?
Absolutely.
Wine?
Yes.
This is the little one, Fire and Ice. There. The red.
Uh-huh.
The
oh yeah. Yellow. Beautiful.
Oh.
Okay. Do you want Fire and Ice? Okay. Well, Liz, without just looking at it, before I'd be interested to talk to you about it.
Is that yours?
There's, yeah. One of the reasons I picked it is because you're kind of doing a lot with less. You know, I think the decision's there to leave it and not overpaint it. It looks very fresh to me, right?
Yeah.
That's especially in a small painting like that, that's very hard to do, I think. You know, so good for you. Usually the additions of the lines would be distracting, but in this case, that the charcoal or whatever it is, with the yellow and the red, that the additional black kind of sews it together somehow.
Yes,
it wouldn't be the same without it. So good for you.
Thank you.
Usually that's a killer.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, usually. That's good to know.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Which is Jan's?
This is Jan's right here. Yeah. Well, that's a nice surprise. I didn't know that was yours. Yeah. Yeah. Well, what's kind of funny is it reminds me of abstract landscape. Right? A lot. And this could be, you know, I was in Kauai last Easter, right? And there's a path, and you do just this. You kind of see there's a bit of trees and things like that, and then there's waterfalls, and then there's cliffs, and then there's the ocean. And you kind of have it there. It's not necessarily in a pictorial order like a photograph is, or like a place is, and yet it's all there.
Okay, but I just decided to go for it, and
good.
It just started happening.
Yeah, and that's oftentimes what, you know, what happens a lot, Jen, is that you have to keep, you will, something will come out of that effort, but not if you don't persist, of course, you know, you won't get it. But if you persist, you know, eventually something will come together.